forest, there's a garden that's forgotten, where the wind blows wild. There are voices in the treetops, and if they stop, better run, we're coming for you, for you. Hello everyone, it's 2 minutes past the hour, and what a lovely surprise to have you all in our discussion room about a very important emerging topic, politics and the future civilizations, possibly eco-civilization, a transformative journey towards a new paradigm. Altogether, a very promising topic, and indeed, it will offer today a lot of space for your own inputs and discussions based on the opening statements of our exceptional guests today. The whole series is part of the Connectathon sessions. Connectathon is a platform for discussions organized by 8 Goals, 1 Foundation, Social Systems Labs, and Ecocivilisation Movement. And with me today, they are all these exceptional people, and I think I will not spend too much time introducing them, but all of them are authors. All of us are authors, system thinkers. We're trying to open questions that seek answers beyond the current understandings of our societies. And I sense that many of you are following the same path. So we will make sure that you get a chance to reflect, challenge our thoughts, and of course, join in a 2 hours lively conversation on this very pressing topic. Allow me first to use this time for a couple of introductory points, and then I will invite my colleagues to join in. First of all, I think we all agree we live in very dynamic times, but probably in the past, pretty much that was said for every single period, because that's what life is all about, is an ongoing, constant change. And it sometimes seems that only humans try to freeze the evolution in time and space and keep it the way it was for the future as well. And as we can see, we are seriously challenged on that kind of attitude. And usually that ends up in a destructive force and in destructive consequences of our acts. But let's just take a moment and clarify a few of the basic concepts we will be dealing with today. First, civilization. What is it? And the most generic definition would be that civilization is generally defined as an advanced state of human society containing highly developed forms of government, science, culture, industry, and common social norms. Civilizations, which is very interesting, when you look back at least for the last 10, 12,000 years, you will see that they're often responsible for their own decline. However, it would not be fair, but admitting that their self-destruction is usually assisted by different forces, either natural or emerging new powerhouses of human emerging societies. What I found very interesting is also that when you study civilization, it's often stressed that the theory of normal accidents suggests that complex technological systems regularly give way to a failure. And if anything, this should be of a close observation in our societies today. Eco-civilizations or eco-civilization definition often refers to a holistic societal model that integrates ecological sustainability and environmental harmony as fundamental principle in the development of human civilization. It envisions a harmonious coexistence between humanity and the planet, recognizing that the health and prosperity of both are intertwined. And this seemed to be very alien to our current political and social frameworks. We are somehow trying to find a way back, but because of the lack of systemic approach, it seems like we are failing more often than succeeding. And it is somehow a consequence of industrial mindset, which defined the last 400 years of human civilizations and kind of pushed first humans to alienate ourselves from nature later on, and pushed us to start living in the cities and serving this industrial system. And then, of course, that was not enough in order to contain people focused on the interest of the industrial mindsets. We needed to alienate humans from each other. And in many aspects, we've done that quite successfully. However, even that was not enough with so-called Nature 3, with the virtual world. We seem to be alienating humans from ourselves. And that's, of course, it's a very reasonable question then. What's the future of human civilization? Are we ready to replace it with transhumanization or concepts? Or can we reawaken our connections with the planet itself, with the natural basic ecosystems, with the universal constellation and relationships, and reinvent really all these relationships to reposition human being back into the more complex, less technological frameworks where technology can basically serve us and not dominate us. So here comes then an attempt to address these issues closely, bringing beautiful minds from all over the world together and try to see the way forward in a more systemic, planet-based, conscious development. Eco-civilization movement is just one little piece to it, but today all of our speakers will present their views, their networks, their roots and backgrounds that brought their thoughts forward. And as you will see today, we are trying to do the network of the network, cross connections and cross pollination of our thoughts and interests and visions and in inner incentives in order to move forward and try to find a moment where the civilizational paradigm might be more guided than being surprised by it and finish on the pile of history like all other previous civilizations have done. So, eco-civilization movement is basically a purpose-driven disruptive cluster, inviting us to unite in a respectful, collaborative endeavor aimed at the safeguarding our planet as an ecological haven within our galaxy. Sometimes it seems bit too big to look the big picture, but only when you really look at the big picture, you can see the situation that you are in. If we take a look at the role of the planet Earth in the constellation of planets, all of a sudden we see what a unique and unbelievable planet that is, full of life and constant evolution. Sometimes we really need to invite ourselves to take this broader view. And considering that we as humans are invited, that we uplift societies best by cross-connecting and harmonizing with the laws of nature and the profound resonance of the source vibration of the universe, which is light, white light, and on the planet Earth, we call it love. So, how does politics fit into the framework of this civilizational paradigms? Well, again, if we take a look at the last couple of hundred years, we will see that our society has been shaped by seven drivers of power, which are very active today. Among others, is corporations, media, aristocracy, religious institutions, science and technology, culture and sport, and politics. All these have access to direct access to resources, or rather, they are granted the managerial power in order to deliver their goals. And for some reason, at one point, these goals became more and more alienated from the overall interest of the society and became a subject of elite, self-called elite groups, who instead of after prosperity, they are after power, of and also very egoistic self-fulfillment. And that's where the anarchy and decadency comes in, especially in the forum of destruction, which is not always a bad thing, as we will probably hear from our next speaker, but definitely needs to be, we need to be aware of it. And I wonder if we can make a shift, and can we even imagine in our minds a different framework within which society evolves. For example, instead of those institutional seven drivers of force of progress, can we build a society that is value-based? For example, instead of institutions, can we put forward the values that empower our relationships, like empathy, stewardship, care, collaboration, inclusion, engagement, and the basic frequency of relationships, which is love? That's an open question, and I hope we will have some good answers today. Before I conclude, I'd like to bring forward a couple of challenges today that are inviting us to take a look at this drivers of progress in the society, as well as civilizational paradigm from a broader systemic perspective. And at the same time, I would propose that these are usually also the change makers. First, there is no doubt today that we are experiencing some severe climate changes, which are mostly related to heavy weather conditions that are appearing all over the world. They are different than they might be 20, 30 years ago, and that they could possibly lead to a serious climate change. We know today that 12,000 years ago there was a big disaster on this planet Earth. That substantially changed the conditions and destroyed more than 80% of entire biodiversity on planet Earth. So, can we prepare for something like that? Is that something normal and usual? Are we, by any chance, in the middle of this process today? How can we readjust? How can we develop resilience for that? I do believe that today our focus on sustainable development is, of course, very much needed, but it's missing a strong resilient component which could help humanity, and along with that also to other species, to have a higher level capacity for readjustments. Then the other very important element that is new, as far as we know today, in our society is land ownership and migration. Today we live in the world where every square meter is claimed. So every migration, no matter how small, is causing serious societal disruptions and possibly leads to even political conflicts that sometimes resolve in very severe conflicts and wars. So that was alien to humanity in the past. People have been migrating for thousands and thousands of years. With every kind of climate change and severe weather changes, people started to move and look for better places to live. Today, this is almost impossible. As you can tell, we have no good solutions for such movements. And we are just at the beginning of understanding this challenge and facing it. Then is global connectivity, which we haven't had such a connected world that is accessible to pretty much every individual and every organization as we have today. And it's a good question. Is this a plus or is it a minus? It's bringing a lot of good positive conditions. I mean, the fact that we can talk today and we are here together today is the result of that. On the other hand, it's also an incredible source of manipulation. So how to develop a human inner spirit and consciousness strong enough that she or he always knows what's right and wrong? Because in the overall constellation of energies globally, that balance exists. It's just, can we access it? How can we clear our sensors in order to get the right sense and to be able to know what's manipulation and what is the real reality? But last but not least, I would like to really bring forward the issue of corporate influence. Especially for politics, this is becoming a serious challenge. It almost seems like the corporations are trying to prove that countries can no longer serve the needs of people, and they try to offer themselves as the next solution. Of course, this cannot be a bigger delusion, because corporations, no matter how socially responsible they always are responsible to their stakeholders, and they need to generate value for stakeholders, which means to an elite group of owners. And they don't have really responsibilities to nations. State has to deliver the well-being of people who live in a certain area and belong to a certain political framework. So this is seriously challenged, and it couldn't be more applicable than discussion about the future of politics and what kind of role it can play in the world that is forthcoming, and how can we co-create something that will serve us based on already acquired awareness and consciousness as humans, individuals and collective. We learned from all isms that happened so far that only when you bring the needs of individual and of collective in a balance, that's where you can get then a balanced society. We're still failing to reach that balance, but at least awareness is there and we know what to seek for. So I hope I did bring some of the points forward that could serve us as discussion points during today's session. And I'd like at the end just like to put some statements forward about the politics the way how I see it today. And it's worth saying that I was at the core of this politics and I could experience it and I could now observe it from the outside as well. Politics is probably one of the last sectors of society that is not open for innovation. So politics is all about power and not innovation. So how can we bring that spirit to politics? Because I think that could make a big difference. It has no inspiration at this point, but only manipulation. And every election is just a great manifestation of that because politicians promise, make big paroles, and then they forget who they serve. It's almost like to be elected is the goal. And once you get there, the job is done, instead of understanding that that's just a beginning. So I can then say that there is no care. There are only numbers. A huge space for improvement and future development. So with that, I would like to invite my dear friend Uffe to pick it up. He is the person who's always strongly driven by his ideas. Not only that, he knows how to manifest them. He manifests them well, And I hope, Uffe, you don't, you're not angry with me when I say that you are a real anarchist. And I respect you for that a lot because you have no compromises in that respect. You go for it, you want a change, and you don't want systems to get comfortable with themselves. So the floor is yours.
Thanks, Violetta. Maybe I would reframe it and say I'm either a Buddhist anarchist or anarchistic Buddhist. I don't know in what the way we should describe it. Anyway, I'll try to, first of all, hello everyone. It's great to be here and thanks for the invitation. And I think that my little presentation will overlap for sure with what you've said, Violetta. I will try to cover it from my perspective. And for those who don't know me, I'm sitting in Copenhagen. So I'm speaking from a very Danish Scandinavian point of view. And I'm totally aware that I'm living in a very privileged corner of the world, with all what that takes. I'll try to do a world premiere now because I want to share my screen and I've never done it before. So let's see what happens. Let's see if it works. Just a second. Okay. I hope you are with me still. My plan for the next 10 minutes is try to just to share where I am in my life and in my thinking these days. And what I'm really struggling with, but also in a creative way, is how can we go from the old system to the new system? If I look into my life, my last 40 years of work, actually I have been split in between working in the old system, like a city councillor or member of the Danish parliament or minister for culture. But that's only part of my work story because I've been also been getting a lot of experience working in the new system. And both as a CEO of the youth movement and organization called the Frontrunners, I've been the founder and the principal of the Chaos Pilots, and lately also founding the first Green Party in Denmark and been a party leader for that, the Alternative. So my own personal life story has been split between, living in both the old system and the new system. And in a way that tells a lot about where I find most fun, to stand with one leg in the known and one leg in the unknown. I've done that for all my life. I've always tried to figure out where is the next innovation, it's so to speak. And just a few more words on my background. The front runners is a very entrepreneurial, but also very social conscious and cultural, very creative environment in the second city of Denmark called Aarhus. They were able to make a create a space in between all the other spaces where young people were able to try to see what it takes to go from idea to reality. And with that experience, after 8 years of working in the front runners, we created the leadership program, the Chaos Pilots. It's a value-based organization, educational higher education institution, and try to totally reframe our educational system and try to figure out how can we create a learning environment that really are motivating for our students, and not only educate them through their minds, but also their hearts and their body. And for me, the next really big innovation it was creating the alternative, the Green Party in Denmark. So I've been getting a lot of experience working in both top-down organizations, but for sure also in what I call the fishnet organizations. And today I'm really starting to understand what kind of value shift is needed in today's world if we should be able to find a new balance. And some of this is for sure very banal, and I expect all the participants on this little seminar, Zoom seminar, can identify themselves with this shift. And maybe the most important shift for me, and again, I know it sounds extremely banal, but for me, it's also extremely important that we really, really understand that humans are part of nature, and we are not something different and above nature. And that's from that perspective, I try to understand both the social system, cultural system, and the political systems through that lenses. And from there, of course, also a deep understanding that we have to go from outer growth perspective to inner growth perspective, going from linear thinking to circular thinking, and from competition to cooperation. Again, oh boy, have you heard all these headlines before? Yes, you have. But it's an ongoing process to really to understand this in a very deep way and integrate it into the way you work, the way you live, and the way you love. So from competition to cooperation, and from hierarchic leadership to a much more holistic leadership that really understand that we have to understand people on so many different levels, and understand that motivation is different from you than me, and how can we move the old system from which is driven from motivation by power and status to a new system driven by motivation, by meaning and purpose. And that is for sure sounds as a very, very big task. And I just want to tell you a very short story from my own country. which is motivating me because when things are really tough, I have to remember myself that yes, it's tough, but we have been doing it before and solved it before, so of course we can do it again. So when I speak about the Danish society to foreigners or international guests, I will always try to describe the development of the Danish society through this understanding that we have been through the what I call the first social innovation wave, and it started all the way back to 1814. And for those who don't know Danish history, and of course you don't do that, something very important happened in Denmark in 1813, and that was the year that Denmark went bankrupt. We allied ourselves with Napoleon and was not part of the winning team. So not only did the English army nearly totally destroyed Copenhagen, took our navy, but we just we went completely economically bankrupt. So why do I then focus on the year after 1814? The reason for that is that that was the year we decided that all kids from 7 year to from first grade to seventh grade should be able to attend public schooling for free. And if you just take that story really to take it in, that the year after we went bankrupt, and then in today's environment, that would mean that people would be fired, and we had to be much more effective, and we work much many more work hours. Then back in 1814, they decided even if we are bankrupt, we invest in the common good. We try to invest in our kids. We try to invest in our education. And from that point, several different movements really took off. And I think that most of you can, yeah, mirror your own experience into this picture, that for sure the corporate movement was extremely important for the Danish society. Something that you are maybe is a bit unfamiliar with is next social movement called the Danish folk high schools. But not to go too much in detail, but the Danish folk high schools offer young people 1 year education, but in a completely grade-free society. So the Danish folk high schools is a kind of an educational environment that with the purpose of enlightenment, not exams, not grades, but enlightenment of our young people. The third movement I would like to focus on is the labor movement. These three movements, if you just go one step deeper into them, what is just under the surface? For me, the cooperative movement mirror new business models. How can we reinvent our economic system? How can we understand business in new ways? How can we understand markets in new ways? So for me, corporate movement is, yeah, new business models. The Danish folk high school movement, I would like to give them the headline cultural and democratic enlightenment. So for me, that's the core of the Danish folk high schools. That's cultural and democratic enlightenment. And the last thing, the labor movement, that covers, of course, the fight against inequality. So if we just for a second imagine that there was something, there was a DNA code in the first social innovation wave that maybe can inspire how can we kickstart the next. And for me and my work right now is I try to create arenas here in Denmark where we try to get out of our different silos. My experience is that human rights activists talk with human rights activists, artists talks with artists, politicians talk with together with politicians, business people talks together with business people. But how can we create spaces and arenas where we talk with each other? And what would happen? Just imagine that the people who are interested and are motivated by the fight against inequality meets the new value-driven entrepreneurs that meets educators and artists. Imagine just for a second the space created and what kind of dialogues and questions can be raised. But that's for me not enough. It's great to create these open tribes. It's great to create these new arenas for new kind of discussion and decision making. But we also try to figure out how can we get out of our us and them mindset and try to develop what I here on the slide has called the fifth position. This is not my framing. It's the framing of a good old friend, Galtung, Johan Galtung, who unfortunately just died a few weeks ago, a great Norwegian peacemaker. What he, in a way, enlightened me, but also my colleagues and the students at the chaos pilots when I was a principal there, was that if there's a competition going on or a conflict goes on, then you have these five possibilities that either A wins and B loses, or B wins and A loses, or maybe we're able to formulate a very boring compromise that no one actually are happy about. There's of course also the possibility that both A and B loses. But what Johan Galtung again and again talked about, how can we create a position where both A and B wins? And I think that these days when we see the level of conflicts that are heating up in nearly all corners of the planet, it's very, very, very easy to to fall in the gap and really try to create enemy pictures of the people we disagree with. Right now, both what is going on in U.S. and I'm really looking forward to hear our American friend, what he has to share, but the way seen from a Scandinavian European position, what is happening in U.S. These days and months up to the next election is extremely dangerous. But we also see these conflicts in Europe. We see what is happening in the Middle East right now between. What is happening in Gaza, which is unbearable. And we see it many, many places in Ukraine, the war in Ukraine. We see what a potential war between China and Taiwan. So how can we try to get out of the trap and find a fifth position? That's my recommendation for our talk. To just to frame it up, let's take the jump, God damn it, and try to figure out how can we each of us make a friendly revolution where we are positioned in our workplace, in our education system, wherever we work, in our local communities, among our friends, in our families, in our love relationships. So let's take the jump and make a friendly revolution.
Thank you very much, Ufa. Many food for thoughts. I put some comments in the chat, so I hope everybody had a chance to see them. At this point, I would like to open the floor for a quick reflections and your thoughts. As I said in the message, how do you feel when you hear all this about civilizational transformations, about the fifth way forward? These are actually substantial changes in the mindset. How do they make you feel? Is it something alien, or is it something that you've been thinking about and waiting to get engaged over and lead the way? And Elke, please go ahead.
Yes, thanks a lot, and great to hear you again, Uffe. Always really interesting to listen to you. And I'm just coming sitting here with a question because I heard you say twice that the alternative was a green party. And I was a little bit surprised about that because I think this ability to go beyond perspectives, like it was an aperspectival, so to speak, position that you're offering here, which I love, is not typically green. So I'm a little bit, I'd like you to elaborate on that, because I always thought you framed yourself as a meta-modern movement or something. Otherwise, yeah, I like the idea, and I didn't know this model by Johann Galtung. So really, was really, yeah, grateful for that. Thank you.
Should I just make a quick response and say hi, Elke? Good to see you again. It's really a family gathering tonight. That's cool. No, but for sure, the alternative in Denmark is a Green Party. And why do I say that? It's because that when we founded the party back in 1913, and I don't want to make it this story too detailed, but just saying that we identified that three major challenges in the world at that time that we wanted to be a political answer to. The first one was to respond to the climate crisis. And that was number one. The second was the empathy crisis, our lack of empathy, both on a personal level but also as society. And the last crisis we wanted to be a political response to was the system crisis, that our systems are getting way too complex. I know that we have a lot of thoughts about civilization collapse, but what we see when a society falls apart, and also even all the way down to institutions, is that the organizations get too complex and there's a lack of energy. That's exactly what is happening in many places. But back to your question, Elke, that yes, for sure, the alternative is a Green Party. And I'm very proud of that we're able to completely push the green agenda in Denmark. And it has some very, it's very, actually very provoking to say that with all the challenges we are facing, the most important one is the climate crisis. And of course, today you would also say the biodiversity crisis. But back in 2013, it was climate, 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 climate. Today it's also luckily biodiversity. But because that with that mindset, you have to change your economic models. You have to completely reorganize the way of living, production, eating, how we organize our cities, how we transport ourselves, etc. So, yes, a Green Party.
Anybody else wants to come in at this point and make a comment? Maybe just a little comment for myself regarding this transformative time frames. I work a lot with local communities, and it takes about 5 years to reshape the corporation and to make a little change on a level of community. It takes about 12 to 15 years. But to really make a change on a country level or even on a larger scale, 30 years is a minimum. And I sometimes joke a little bit because the depreciation cycle of an airplane or a ship is 25 to 30 years. So we are somehow stuck with this time and space relationship as well. That's why it's so important that we build a very broad coalitions and try to connect the world, not only on a local level, but then have patience and persistence to deliver the change on a local level. So that just as an additional comment. So anyway, anybody else wants to come in? There are a couple of comments in the chat. Bonwin, do you want to come in?
Yes, hello everybody.
Yes.
Thank you very much for these provocations. And yes, I do resonate very much with it. And one of the things I felt is and I felt both, I can feel overwhelmed by the gap between the sort of ambition of the vision of change and both the time thing that you've just mentioned and the what Ufa mentioned is the mundanity, but I actually really appreciated that point. And I feel like, although there's a part of me that feels that the mundanity is a response that other people would have to reject the importance of this, but there's something very important in that. I mean, Ufa, you yourself said it seems mundane, but it's actually so deep. And if there's a way of making explicit how we can encourage people to do very small things, but in the light of this big story that makes those small things both important and deep and also feasible. And there's such a mania for ambition at all scales in our innovation culture that there's something, yeah, really important in that I feel like I think about more.
Thank you very much for your comment as well. I think it's
Just
important.
a quick response, because actually, when I talked about the cooperative movement or the folk high school movement and the labor movement, it all started with a conversation. And I have to, we have to, in a way, to hold that concept in our head that it starts with small steps, but we're in it for a long run. I totally agree with Violetta that we have to really understand that it takes years to create solid results. But when that is said, we have to remember that the reason why the cooperative movement in Denmark started was because there was a priest in one of the countrysides regions of Denmark who said, "Can't we invent the way we understand a shop? Can't we create a shop where the customers are members and owners?" Or if we look into the farming co-op movement, it was exactly the same. People, and that's actually a very important message from my end, is that this big change in the Danish society was not organized by the parliament or the prime minister's office. It was started because normal people, ordinary people, came together and created meaningful communities and solved concrete problems. And the last thing I would say, I don't want the I don't hope that you hear that I'm a ambassador for modernity or whatever you called it. I don't use that phrase. I know that somebody else do it, but I don't. That's what not where I'm speaking from. Where I'm speaking from is a very human perspective that I know that. God damn, us humans can be so much more fun and lively and energetic, and have much more interesting and tough and deep conversation than we normally have. And it starts basically that you are listening to yourself and start to feel yourself, because if you can't feel yourself, you can't feel the world. So guys, start to listen.
Thank you, Ulfa. We have one more comment before we move to the next part, which is Marcelle, please.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Violeta, thank you very much for this nice evening. I'm Marcelle. I'm a negotiator of the Union for the Drinking Water Sector in the Netherlands. And Ulfa is so right. We are born in the wealthy place on Earth. So my specialist as a negotiator and also a local politician, I'm always searching for the triple win. Most of the time we speak about win-win situation, and you can see it in the wonderful presentation about A and B in the win-win, but I'm always looking for the triple win. So it doesn't make part A and B a little sad or a little happy. There's always a third part that is also happy too. And then you can take little steps. And in Holland, we call that polder model. There's no English word for polder model. like the three sisters. Yes, indeed, the comment was very right. So maybe that's the fifth position. And maybe it inspires you to take the triple win with you tonight.
Thank you very much for this affirmation as well, and share of your thoughts and experiences. And it's my duty to move on. We have two more important messages to hear from two very important groups. First, I'd like to announce Indra Annan and Pat Kane. And I hope you have heard about them, but if not, they are behind the Alternative UK, which is a political platform, which asks the question, if politics is broken, what's the alternative? Very provocative thought. And they've dedicated their lives in order to find the answer to this question. Another very important message attracted my attention, and you will find it on their webpage as well, which says the human revolution has to occur on the inside first. So let's hear from them and be ready to make comments. And then last but not least, we will hear from Jeremy, and I will introduce him right after. Indra, Pat, the floor is yours.
Thanks very much indeed. And thank you, Violeta and Ulfa, for setting the scene so well. And we'll do our best to follow up well. So I'm Indra Adnan. And Pat, do you want to just introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Pat Kane. Hi.
So we're the co-initiators of The Alternative. And you might immediately be thinking, oh, that's funny. That's another alternative. And in fact, it's true that we started our project 7 years ago, almost just the beginning of this month, actually, as a sister project, really, to Uffe Elbæk's party, The Alternative in Denmark. And now I'm also going to share some slides, I hope. Strangely. There you go. All right, can everybody see that all right? Okay, so just by way of a very broad introduction, we began the Alternative UK 7 years ago on the 1st of March. And what I want to just bring into the frame and re-emphasize is that the Pat and I had both been working in the arena of politics in different ways over decades, in fact. And we got to the point where we really did think, as Violeta just mentioned, politics is broken, what's the alternative? But what drew us to the Alternative in Denmark wasn't just that it was an experimental political party, but it had at its core this idea of human development, you know, the idea that human beings themselves are ready for something new. And having watched Ufa's work with the chaos pilots and other, you know, work in the cultural sector, having been a minister for culture as well, we knew that this was very core to a shift in politics, that it should really emphasize human capacity again. More than that, maybe, when we actually first met the alternative in Denmark, the reason we were so drawn to that party and its members was the sheer energy. It had, you know, the force of attraction. And it was so very different from anything that we were experiencing in politics up to that point. So literally, you know, the idea that politics should be something that is full of joy and energy, and it's very compelling, and it's drawing young people, and it's being successful. This was really a power that we wanted to somehow share in. So Pat, maybe you'd like to.
Sure. Well, and also there was also another historical moment or moment of experience that triggered the formation of the Alternative UK, the Alternative Global, which was the murder of Joe Cox. And I think, you know, Indra, I think, was attending one of the great Danish political festivals when that happened in the run-up to the Brexit vote, so which then went to leave. So the whole role of the whole question of exploring new forms of power beyond official politics came to a dramatic head. There was clearly a failure of official political discourse and official political practice. It couldn't be more spectacular a failure and tragic and drastic a failure than the assassination of Joe Cox. So one of the very early emphases that we had, I'm an artist and writer and as a soft power advocate and psychotherapist, is that we had to think about where the emotional need was in politics alongside the material need. I mean, simply, this is a tale that what they call feels over reels is a story of populism. It's a story of politics over the last 15, 20 years. And it's about time that it was addressed in its fullness, not just with numbers and statistics, as Violetta would say, but also with an understanding of human nature, human emotions. We need an emotional literacy so that we can have a proper politics.
So when we began to look outside of the when we began to look at the statistics around political parties, as we were all part of a party politics, we discovered that, in fact, only 2% of people in the UK, and this is a pattern across Europe and America, only 2% of people are actively members of political parties. So that's a very important statistic, because then you have to ask the question, what are the 98% doing with their energies and their times and their desires for some sort of agency or power? So shifting our attention for a new politics away from the current political system and beginning to see that we need to resource it amongst the people, within communities, in the places where people gather, with the values that people are sharing with each other in their daily lives, that became the direction, the new direction, the new resourcing of a political culture for the future. So again, core to, and we're going to rush through these slides quite a lot in order to, but which is why we're using images. And that's part of the message really, is that maybe it's more the images than the words that will really get across what it is that we're trying to achieve. So here we're talking about how our socioeconomic political system till now has really alienated human beings from themselves and turned us into numbers so that we can be better managed and we can become part of a system of economic growth, really leaving our human selves behind. How do we move on from that? And the goal, if you like, of a new politics that we began to formulate quite early is that we should be able to find a reconnection between the complex and emotional and spiritual world of the human being with the planet that we're living on. So to find this connection between the I and the world, we also had to find the vehicle, if you like, the we that can hold that space. So this I-we world axis for a new politics became the core, if you like, of a new possible political system. Pat, do you want to speak any more to these images?
Not really. I think we can get to the next one quite quickly, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, and the question of the social question of what are the sort of forms of organization and community that can express a politics that fully explores full spectrum human nature is a really interesting question. And we've been exploring that, and we've been testing that and prototyping forms of that. We have an idea of citizens' action networks, or CANs, as containers for all those discussions about power and resources and meaning and purpose that evade and are beyond the party political framework, which is what meanings people are drawing from culture, the relationships, their thoughts about the planet, their thoughts about the universe. We've tried to invent new language for that, not institutes, but constitutes. We're very, very taken by the Alternative's desire to create, and in Denmark, the Alternative's desire to create platforms, parties as platforms that support people's creative enterprise, as much as dragoon them into becoming voting fodder for one election or one referendum. So, but it's in terms of the innovation that Violetta was talking about that is sorely lacking in official politics. I think part of that innovation can be looked at by, and we have been looking at it over these 7 years, by people coming up with new forms of collective organization, new forms of social containers for energies that are not expressed by official politics. Shall I speak to this, Andrew?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very briefly. And we've tried to really address this practically. So, for example, if you want to express the full humanity of a community, it probably needs a media appropriate to that that can reflect both their own local concerns, but also their planetary consciousnesses, the fact that they know they're on a planet, that there are forces across the planet, environmental, technological, that are coming right up to their doorstep. And so what is the media that can help people comprehend that? So we've been running something called the Daily Alternative. Literally does what it says on the front. It provides a daily post of an alternative take on the world of news, on the world of opinion. So basically, that has built up into an archive, which is almost like a kind of simulation of an alternative reality, but based in people's experiments that we've picked up, that we've heard of, that we've decided to profile. We have a very strong taxonomy on the blog, so that we actually are thinking quite self-consciously about the categories of reality that we want to capture, and that then will inspire action rather than create inaction or passivity or despair. So making your own media is one of the practical ways that we've thought that we could do a new politics, and that we've been encouraging people to build media capacity in communities, partly by experiment, but partly by showing by example, as this page illustrates.
And I would say perhaps less simply news or opinion, and more, you know, from the front lines of I, we, and world.
Yes.
So we do regularly report innovation in the world of self-development. We're reporting from the ground about community agency networks. And then we're always trying our best to link that to new news and understanding, not simply of the planet, but of what we call cosmolocalism, how human beings are able to connect with each other at a planetary level. So all this while, we're weaving, if you like, a new story about the possibilities for our future, arising directly from the innovation that's taking place on the ground around the world.
Yep.
So one of the global phenomena, one of the things that we noticed over this seven-year period, we've begun to notice it very early on, is that There's a pattern. There's been a pattern arising for many decades of communities of all different sizes moving in an interrelationship with themselves, crossing the traditional divides that have been that have been offered to them or forced upon them, let's say, from the national level. And people who are living together in a place, wanting to come together to meet each other, sometimes to bring social entrepreneurship, sometimes to begin to solve local problems. But this desire for people to come together in the place where they live and begin to reflect and address the multiple crises that we're reading about. Now, in some cases, it's a very low-level connection. It's mainly just conversation, people making relationship, creating some kind of convivial spaces. But others are very, very ambitious. And you'll recognize some of these, the Transition Towns Network that wanted to be, towns full of people practicing permaculture and wanted to signal to the rest of the country, we're the forerunners of a green future. Some of them are eco-villages. I think, Violetta, you know a lot about the eco-villages. Again, they're modeling new forms of community, new ways of living together. We found a lot of these in South Africa, particularly during COVID. They were forming very quickly. And across the different parts of South Africa, the more privileged, the less privileged, there was a very good connectivity with people helping each other out. So this idea, and of course, Cooperation Jackson is a cooperative of which there are, as Ufa described, hundreds of thousands across the world. This pattern of people coming together, forming kind of circular communities, trying to respond through in nature. We think of this as a kind of fractal organizing because they have a lot in common with each other. It's not that they've instructed each other. There's no top-down authority saying there's only one way to do this and you have to do it this way. These have sprung up fairly spontaneously in relationship to each other, and because of the internet, are now able to connect and sense their commonality. So, in 2022, having blogged like this for 5 years by then, we got the sense that there was so much activity going on globally that was still quite disconnected. Not that many people don't necessarily know about each other's enterprises and innovations. So we wanted to offer some idea, just an image, if you like, that there was somewhere to go with all of that. And we named this idea Planet A, and we said it's open to all. Pat, maybe you'd like to speak a bit to what we
Sure.
call Planet A.
Well, I think Planet A is an example of eco-civilizational politics, because what it says is it deals with the frame in which you're in, and to actually frame living on this planet as your urgent political task is something that we need to sh shift towards. And I think the imperatives of eco-civilization compel us to be planetary citizens. But how do we practically do that? How do we break that ambition down into specific spheres of action? And so there we have, you might be able to see on the screen, we have the alternative media system, which I was just talking about. iPlanetarian, and I guess this is what we're doing right now, is talking about a planetary eco-politic, a cosmo-local politics. But new energy sources is an interesting category for you to conjure with. And again, that comes back to our 2%, 98% critique of existing politics. What are the resources for energy that are cultural, consciousness, spiritual, psychological, artistic, practical, craft-oriented? I mean, there's a whole, not just a seven-eighths, but a 2%, 98% iceberg under the water of ways in which we can be inspired to escape from a passivity that the corporate system wants us to have in relation to acting powerfully in our own lives. So why not live on that? Let's make a choice to live on that planet. I think it's kind of also evoking game culture and virtuality, or the kind of culture of virtuality that we have, and maybe saying we don't really need a headset to get there. We can actually do that from an act of mental imagination.
Yeah, in a sense, you elect yourself to live on planet A.
Yeah.
And in so doing, you're saying no to Elon Musk. There's no need to move to Mars. We worked an interesting Elkafina's here because we worked together with Elka's European organization Lyft for some time to develop the idea of Planet A, and it became a very broad concept for us. But still, we found with our we had 700 co-creators who wanted to have some direct purchase on how to be involved directly with the movement of that we were pointing at, which we were calling the alternative. And so on March the 1st, 2023, we did another little shift in the way that we organized ourselves by naming four, what we call four incubators. And these are really, if you like, four takes on the new reality that we are trying to conjure up. And then, therefore, they offer four entry points into standing on planet A. Some of you will recognize this as sort of a four quadrant approach of the relationship between individuals and the environment. But just to quickly, just to briefly describe, one of these entries is what we've been describing already in this presentation is the school of learning, if you like. How does the individual become fit for the future? So the people who want to think about that particularly, maybe initiate projects in that, are join this future being incubator. The second one here is, refers to how do the community agency networks of community agency networks globally, how do they practically lead to an eco-civilization? So you could see that in 2023, we started to imagine that a real goal for all of the work that we're doing could be described as an eco-civilization. It's a term that we heard almost in the ether to start with. And then more practically, we heard it from individuals, not least Violetta herself, and then Jeremy Lent, who you're going to hear from next. It becomes a term that somehow is the largest possible vision for a future that we could all buy into as human beings. At the same time, we knew that we needed a new media system. And then finally, we also know that we need a new political system, not a new political party, a new way of being political. So that led then to what happened this year on March the 1st, 2024, the birth of a new political system. Pat, perhaps you'd like to, and I know that we're running a bit short of time, so we're going to whip through these next few slides to try to help you to see what this new proposition is. And there's plenty of information on it on our website as well.
Yeah, very, very quickly, Spring is a political project which is beginning in Scotland. We've moved to Edinburgh. Scotland has a proportional system, unlike Westminster, which is a first-past-the-post system. So there's a possibility of answering the question, politics is broken, what's the alternative, under a different political set of possibilities. And we're not about creating a party, but we're not open to it either. But the point is to have a kind of cultural force, cultural and social force that drives you to that position. So some of the things, again, in the context of eco-civilization, we're all stumbling around, but we're trying to figure out what the core offers and the core values of such an eco-civilizational politics would be. Natality is a great, is a beautiful term. It's the opposite of mortality. It's probably another opposite of fatality. It comes from Hannah Arendt, and Bob Dylan also. He not busy being born is busy dying. But the idea that we should be encouraging a vital politics, a life energy politics, and we should be thinking about forms of deliberation and discussion that enable and help, that are complex rather than simplistic and polarized. So we have various things that we've been exploring. One thing you might want to go and look up is the idea of the anti-debate, which is what our friends Perspectiva are bolting together. But the whole idea is that if we should try to have a politics that is emotionally literate, that is participative and collaborative, and to some extent, and bringing people together to think about themselves, their immediate environments, the planet, and the future prefigures the eco-civilization. There's an awful lot of possibility for that inventiveness to be happening, but you kind of have to win the heart battle first to get people to be motivated to do it. But through new inputs and radical and novel inputs, we think that could be done. And I think that's probably the next slide, Indra. Well, yeah, and one of them is to think differently about the economy. We are showered with ideas for new economic practice, for critiques of the existing neoliberal model. We have stuff that's coming in from heterodox economists, stuff that's coming in from games culture, stuff that's coming in from crypto. We're in a sort of from modern monetary theory or ecological economics. We're in a kind of an embarrassment of riches of alternatives to the existing economic model. One of the things we would like to do with Spring, as a political project of eco-civilization, is to bring that alternative economic literacy to communities and to give them a sense that these systems of value can value other things rather than just purely monetary value. The technology is there, the ideas are there, the philosophy is there, and we should find spaces in our lives to experiment that and try out new ideas of economic practice. I mean, particularly given technology on one side and planetary limits on the other, is going to really rip up the existing economic settlement. So we owe it to ourselves to survive our own future to begin to experiment with different kinds of economy under the idea of spring.
And I think what maybe the image should just keep reminding us of all the time is that it's really through community and relationship that this new economy will arise. That this is not something that we're waiting to come from outside. It's not something that we're waiting to be given to us in a way by the current system. It's something that is arising organically from within communities. Sometimes through bringing their own currencies, but developing new forms of capital, that this is something that is arising from the human beings that are coming back to life. Just quickly, Spring then is also a communication system. I think Pat already described a little bit earlier on how important it is for us to be able to offer something alternative to people when they're looking for hope and they're looking for some new solution to the problem. That we're being systemic about that and systematic about it, drawing information from the community agency networks around the world, giving them interconnectivity with each other, but also doing the job of translating that, telling a new story to people who are not even interested in this question, people who are not political, people who are, in a sense, distrustful of newness. Still, we find that there are points of attraction that we can generate from a new kind of media system. And then finally, the thing I suppose that we started with you know, what is in fact the new political system that we're offering? And I hope that it's become clear that all of this energy that we're describing is coming from the 98%. It's an era of self-organization that has been slowly building since over the 30 years that we've had the internet. And what we believe is taking shape and what we are encouraging to take shape is a kind of a parallel polis, you know, a way for people to self-organize, not in a way to want to overthrow the government, but eventually to be in a good partnership with the current system, so that there can be, in a way, a hard power, soft power, partnership towards a better future. At this moment, we don't have anything like this except a few sporadic citizens' assemblies, people's assemblies, very disconnected and still being run by the old political system. But what we're seeing right now, especially with the advent of new technology, is the possibility of all the community agency networks that we've seen moving into relationship with each other and beginning to develop some sort of self-governance that helps them to take decisions about their future that will influence the current system, but also support all the efforts of the people within within that emergence. So that is, if you see the two legs up there, it's two legs, one body. The one on the right is really trying to describe what we see emerging now amongst people that can be hugely enhanced over the next 5 years are going to be very crucial for that.
Yeah, we've been told we have to cut down and get out of here. So just to let you know that all of this political innovation may land itself in Scotland and hopefully the rest of the UK and all the rest of Europe. But we're here in Edinburgh to start the process. Next slide, Andrew. So let's see what organically grows. It might not require political representation. It might be the obvious thing. But for all these arguments to have the political representative voice is a possibility. We are open to it. It may happen. And that might be an ironic outcome of what's politics is broken, what's the alternative 7 years ago. But it might well be that we're in a situation where we can have a voice for eco-civilization in a national parliament. That would be nice. It's not necessary, but it would be nice. So I think that's us.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you all very much.
Well, thank you to both of you. Well designed, well experienced, very challenging. A lot of questions, but it's so good to see that something like this already exists. So thank you for giving your life for this. And let's hope we can jointly see the fruits of your efforts and your well-thought processes. I think this is a long-lasting travel. And the comments and reflections of every single person count, because only in a multicultural framework of reflections we can see really the way forwards and can see different challenges and opportunities. But before I open the floor for a discussion, which I'm sure you have many questions and comments about, I would like to introduce the last speaker, the last guest of today's session, and it's my honor to invite Jeremy Lent to the floor. He leads an open community for people who recognize that our civilization is in existential crisis and who want to engage with others in facilitating a deep transformation towards a life-affirming future on regenerated Earth. What an invitation. And you can see why we're sitting here together with him. He made an incredible presence globally with his book, The Web of Meaning, which integrates science and traditional wisdom to lay out a solid foundation for a worldwide view of deep interconnectedness. And The Guardian made a very clear statement about Jeremy, one of the greatest thinkers of our age. So, Jeremy, it's a real privilege and pleasure to bring you on board on this session. And please feel free to reflect a bit on what you've heard. And of course, we are eager to hear your part of contribution.
Great. Well, thanks so much for that introduction, Violetta. And wonderful to be part of this conversation. So inspiring in so many different dimensions that we've been hearing. What I'll do is I'll share some slides and probably take about 10, 15 minutes max, and then it'll open the space for a conversation. What you'll see in these slides is basically it's like a vision of an ecological civilization. Interestingly, one that developed through work I've done with a lot of people. I'm based in California, but from around the world. And then we sort of we got to connect with the eco-civilization vision of Violetta. So it's such a rich thing to discover these kind of strands of thoughts going around and then connecting together and creating something more emergent. So you will see echoes of a lot of the themes that Violetta's brought up, the Ofe, and then Indra and Pat have been talking about. So I think it'll be interesting to see how these come together. So I'm going to share the screen right now. And hopefully you'll see it's called Envisioning an Ecological Civilization. And well, basically, to begin with, I would like you to imagine essentially a computer program that's just run amok, that things are not working, is going completely out of control. And all around, computer programmers are trying to find these bugs to fix it. Every time they fix it with a bug, it only gets worse and worse. And then finally, somebody comes up and yells, "We've got to change the operating system." That's what I'm going to be taking you through, that idea of what might be to change the operating system of our entire global Earth system. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with this kind of image, how we're rapidly heading for a precipice. This is the planetary boundaries framework that Johan Rockström and his team have put together. And again, probably people are aware of this, but all around the world, scientists are like trying to say, we're going to end our civilization. We're on collective suicide if we don't do something to change this. So what this presentation is really about is exploring what that might mean to actually change the global operating system, basically from capitalism to one that is more like an affirmation of life. And we can understand, first let's kind of think about what this operating system is about. Ultimately, it comes from our dominant values of our world, which really based on separation. I think this picture is iconic of what I mean by that. Everyone's so connected with their technology, separate from each other, separate from the food they're about to eat. And if you look at what that modern story of separation really is about, it looks like something like this, that nature is a machine. Humans are separate from nature. Humans are essentially selfish and competitive, that human progress arises from the conquest of nature, right? That the earth is a resource to exploit for human benefit. And the purpose of life is to, well, basically just get wealthy and powerful. Now, this, we're so imbued in this that it seems like, well, that's the way the world is, or that's how people are. But it's actually a very unique worldview that just emerged really for the first time in history in early modern Europe, with people like Francis Bacon, the prophet of the scientific age, who got people inspired with the idea that we can extend the power of dominion of the human race itself over the universe, or render ourselves masters and possessors of nature. And the Europeans at that time thought of humanity basically as white Western European Christian males. So they viewed they had a right to not just conquer nature, but conquer other continents too. And it was through that that the, hold on a sec, that the, this worldview of separation that came out from modern Europe led to see nature as a resource, others as resources, led to these ideas of human supremacy over the rest of nature, white supremacy over other races, leading to extraction and exploitation as underlying values of our system of global capitalism that we have today. And we're truly dominated by global capitalism, although to the point that 69 of the world's 100 largest economies are not nation states, but transnational corporations, just like Violetta was mentioning earlier. And the thing about global capitalism is it's based on a requirement of perpetual growth. The values of companies are not based on what they're offering now, but what investors expect they'll be offering 20 years into the future. It's a system designed to mint billionaires and one that's led to the greatest inequality in history, with roughly two dozen billionaires owning as much wealth as half the world's population of 4 billion people. And the core design principles of this operating system, basically to maximize shareholder returns, keep growing at all costs, material consumption being a proxy of welfare, and non-human nature as a resource to exploit. And it leads to this extractive directive of monetizing everything as fast as possible, turning humans into conditioned consumers, exploiting every available resource on Earth. And as a result of that, we're basically looking at one of the greatest transitions in human history. We're either going to be headed for collapse as a result of this overconsumption, or to something like a sort of a fortress Earth or a techno split, where the wealthy elites basically cut themselves off from the rest of the world that endures collapse. From a moral standpoint, maybe even more morally egregious than collapse itself. But this is the question: can we find that path of sustainable flourishing that's different from those two? And that's what more and more people around the world are calling an eco-civilization or an ecological civilization. And to get to that point, what is required is a transformation in the basis of our global civilization from one that is wealth-based to one that is life-based. Essentially, a global cultural and economic system that would promote sustainable flourishing for humans and the earth. Essentially, the overriding objective of the entire civilization would be to create the conditions for all people to flourish as part of a thriving, living earth. And it's not just the work that Violetta and Indra and Pat and Ove and I are doing, but this is what's so exciting about this vision. It's shared by so many different groups all over the world. In South America with Buen Vivir and Sumac Corsay, and in Africa with Ubuntu, Indra's mentioned things like transition towns, people pursuing degrowth movements, spiritually engaged Buddhism, deep ecology, traditional Chinese principles, different political movements. This is what's exciting, is that all these millions ultimately of movements are pointing towards this shared direction of a life-affirming civilization. And this can be based on the principles of ecology itself. Essentially, like how living systems self-organize. Because ecosystems, in fact, can remain resilient for millions of years if they're not being basically destroyed by human civilization. And one of the basis of these is the realization that far from what our current operating system tells us, nature is not actually selfish. And evolutionary biologists now know if you look back over billions of years, the great steps in And the complexity of life on Earth that led to this abundant world we live in today all came about not through extra competition, but through increases in cooperation between different organisms. Life evolved through cooperation. In the words of systems biologist Lynn Margulis, life didn't take over the world by combat, but by networking. And in fact, when hominids appeared, it actually was arising not from us learning how to outcompete those around us, but from us learning how to cooperate even more powerfully than before. When our human ancestors, hominids, first found themselves in the Great Rift Valley in a different environment, they were vulnerable to predators. Those who learned to collaborate were the most successful. And over time, our identity expanded from self and kin to include the entire group. So the human ability to cooperate with each other, even those who are not kin, is actually what differentiates us from other primates. So we evolved what are called moral emotions, things like compassion, gratitude, guilt, shame, or embarrassment. We don't just act morally because we think we should, but because it actually feels right to us as human beings. And indigenous cultures have long known that. That's that concept of Ubuntu that Violetta mentioned before in the chat. I am because you are. Or in North America, the Lakota have a concept called Mitakui Oyasin. We are all related, not just talking about each other and humans, but all of life around them being related. So if we look just really briefly what some of the principles would be of that sort of ecosystem resilience, of that what an ecological civilization would look at if it was applied to human civilization. Basically, it looks something like this, that fundamentally, this notion of symbiosis, that each party gains from a reciprocal relationship. Pretty much just a scientific word of saying exactly that, that fifth alternative that Ofe was mentioning earlier. And that would be really the foundation of an ecological civilization, leading to fairness, justice, equity, and individual dignity. Recognizing that nature is a holarchy and each is part of a greater whole. And so the health of the whole system requires the flourishing of each part. That's known as fractal flourishing. We'd see it in terms of diversity, that a system's health depends on differentiation and integration, with the inherent right of each person and community to participate in cultural, political, and economic power. We'd see balance, with every part in a harmonious relationship with the entire system, to lead to like a steady state economy with equitable distribution of wealth and power. Subsidiarity is key. Like the grass, literally grassroots self-autonomy. The grass doesn't look to some other part of the ecosystem to tell them what to do. They grow right there in the grassroots. So in an ecological civilization, that means pushing decision-making to the lowest level possible in the system. And then there's embeddedness, recognizing humanity as being part of the natural world, as Ofe and others have mentioned already today, tending Mother Earth rather than trying to control her. And finally, there's the concept of regeneration, sustainable flourishing into the long-term future. Here in North America, the Iroquois Confederacy had in their constitution that in our every deliberation, we must consider the impact of our decisions on the next seven generations. So basically, to summarize, what we're looking at is a transformation in values, emphasizing the quality of life rather than material possessions, basing our choices, political, social, and economic, on our shared humanity, with justice and dignity for all, and building civilization's future on the basis of symbiosis with the living earth, where the flourishing of the natural world is a foundational principle. And we won't, of course, go into it in detail right now, but every one of those principles applies all across civilization. This is a key element of this vision. That doesn't just apply, we're not just talking about ecological economics or things like that, but every aspect of what we consider civilization can and needs to be transformed to be life-affirming. And again, I won't read even these out in detail, but these words you'll see there, things like universal basic income, distributed ledger and technology, rights of nature, disassembling patriarchy, citizens' assemblies. These are the kinds of specifics we're talking about, all arising from that foundational life-affirming basis. So if you do want to join this conversation online, Violetta was mentioning, I put the link in the chat already, invite you to join the Deep Transformation Network. It's thousands of people from around the world who have joined. And we have monthly live meetings, all kinds of stuff, asynchronous feeds going on. It's basically a global community exploring pathways toward an ecological civilization. So that's my prepared slides. Let me stop my screen share right now. And back to you, Violetta, if you want to take it from here. I think you're on mute, Violetta.
Thank you very much for this brief but very concise presentation. I cannot but ask you one question. Where do you see politics to fit into your model?
Yeah, great question. And really, I think politics is one of the most important things that needs to be rethought of, reconceived, very much along the lines of what Indra and Pat and the alternative Ofe is working on or talking about. I think citizens' assemblies really points the way more than anything to what's actually possible. And it's potential to take the what has already been accomplished with citizens' assemblies, but in limited ways, and expand that notion beautifully to actually consider the notion of governance itself by a group of normal people chosen by sortition. There's a brilliant political philosopher called Ellen Landamore, who's written a book really reconceiving politics in that way, the notion of mini-publics actually leading to governance. And then, of course, We have things like participatory budgeting for municipalities, where that's when subsidiarity is really really allows really implemented in the right way, that leads to this reconception. And I think that leads all the way to global governance. So there's this, if we look at theories of the commons, and I don't know if people are familiar with Eleanor Ostrom's work, looking at the principles of the commons, and David Sloane Wilson, a brilliant evolutionary biologist, has taken these principles and looked at how that can be applied to pro-social behavior around other communities. That can be polycentric, that can be fractally scaled. So ultimately, of course, we're a long, long, long way from that right now, but I think the workable vision is actually for deep-root subsidiarity governance to then be polycentric, so it extends all the way up to a global governance that would be empowered to deal with global issues rather than ones that have to, that could be dealt with at local levels.
Great. And I'm inviting now everyone to reflect and raise questions to Indra, Pat, and Jeremy. And while you're getting warm up, I have one more question for both of you. Jeremy, you mentioned in your presentation that there have been many cultures in the past couple of centuries back that have had already very advanced structures that were close to nature. We know about that. We had Carantania here, this magical state where a lot of democracy has been developed. We know that Europe actually had much more democracy in the early centuries than later on. So, how do you both relate to that? I mean, are we reinventing ourselves or just remembering? Or are we really up to something new? I mean, how can we avoid this vicious circle that we keep destroying ourselves just to remember that we've already had solutions once in the past?
I think that's a great question. And yeah, I would basically say, yes, we're rediscovering a lot of deep layers of knowing that early human communities had, sent especially back from the nomadic hunter-gatherer times, when there was that's where these principles of the commons first evolved, basically, in those places. And but we are looking at something new, because we have to essentially reconceive some of those other notions that existed more locally and say, how can that be applied to a global civilization? So, I mean, something to be aware of, and I've often got pushback on this, is the very idea of the word ecological civilization. People who look deeply, they say, that's an oxymoron. That doesn't make any sense. Civilization is by, there's never been a civilization that has not been hierarchical and destructive. That's not necessarily true. You got things like Mohenjo-Daro, Daro might have been more egalitarian, but that's beside the point. For the most part, that's true. And I think that what we need to recognize is this vision of what's possible. It is really, it would be a major break from the past. It would be the first time in all of human history that we've reconceived something, that we've gone to these core layers of what allows flourishing for humanity on the earth, and then applied them in a global, highly technological, sophisticated way. So there's no minimizing the ambition we're talking about. It's really breaking new ground, but it's remembering what we've known in early human history.
Excellent. Indra, Pat, and then I pass the word to Arti.
I mean, one thing I'd like to offer, without disagreeing with what anyone has said so far, is that I'd like to evoke Buckminster Fuller, and the idea that we have to build a new system that makes the old one obsolete. And one of the things that we've had to conjure with, and we are constantly conjuring with, and are still conjuring with, is the idea of a public space that was entirely designed by men. So when we talk about the old system or the current system, the one that's breaking down, we're nearly entirely referring to the public space as it was designed by men. We're talking about the institutions and the civilization, that we're grappling with. It sits in our head in that way. At the same time, we've always had a private space that was not the public space, that was more or less run by women. So whether we're talking about communities or we're talking about families or we're talking about what sometimes is pointed at as in indigeneity, women had a lot of power in that space. And what's happened over the last 30 years and this shift that we've all been describing is how the sensibility and the structures and the architecture that women create has moved into the public space. So I would describe it as evolution. It's not change in the sense of it's almost impossible to change the old system to the new one. But if we think about what has been evolving because of technology mostly, our awareness, a changed public space, that's why I think we can talk about the future in a way that we've never been able to talk about it before. And we will, and that will continue that way because it's almost now, we're almost describing now the feminization of public space when we're thinking about networks and the kind of ecological sensibility that Jeremy's been describing.
Excellent. Artie, what do you think about it?
Oh, well, thanks, Violetta. And thank you, Indira, Pat, Uffe, and Jeremy. Brilliant insights. So let me give you a base for why I'm going to ask the question. So I've done about two papers for the High Level Political Forum and the SDG Summit for the UN. And honestly, even being at COP28, I realized that this is one of the biggest human organizations on the planet, which is heavily directionless. So when we try and write these, when we write these papers, we try to create a certain direction. We try to create, a pathway for the civil society aspirations to reach member states. The third paper that I'm doing is for the Summit of the Future, and there are many sections that we are writing in there. One is on peace and conflict, and that is something which is possibly one of the primary responsibilities of any political system. So the aspiration that we are creating for political leaders is to recognize that they do not lead countries, but they've been given the keys to the town to take care of it. So it is about patriotism expanding beyond the boundaries of countries and going at a more planetary level. Now, when we look at peace and conflict as a system, there are two things that are acting on it constantly and intergenerationally, I would say. One is the here, and pardon my saying that, kind of controversial, but let me table it, is the obedience that is expected and propagated through religious institutions, instilling fear amongst people to rise up against their circumstances. One second is, so it's a trick question. When there is no war in times of peace, how does conflict continue? Which is that one human organization or system that has zero error rate or minimal error, the most, the least error rate, and also is extremely collaborative. So, like I said, it's a trick question. What comes to mind when I say, what is that human system that is just so foolproof? The mafia.
Yeah.
Right. So in third world countries where a lot of garbage is exported, we have garbage mafia, then we have natural resources mafia, then we have water mafia in Africa. When we look, I mean, it's astounding. When I look at Africa as a kid, when I was growing up in India, by the way, that's where I'm from and I am right now, I used to think Africa is a culture which is very independent from every other culture and religion that I'm familiar with. But as of today, Africa is dominated by every other culture and religion, but its own. And it's almost like a huge mass of land which is being, waited upon to be exploited once genocide in different shapes and sizes is carried out. So I'm looking at systems, and this is going to go into the Pact of the Future at the Summit of the Future. And this is the direction that I'm taking, and I'd like insights into what do we think about it. Of course, I understand that the dynamics of the Western world politics is very different from, the global South and the global North. There's a difference in how it is managed. But how do you see these two heavyweight influences on politics sort of coming down like the Tower of Sauron?
Well, Uffe, Indra, Pat, and Jeremy.
The only
Short
thing,
responses, short.
yeah, there's a political philosopher called Chantal Mouffe who once wrote about the distinction between antagonism and agonism. So antagonism is you basically are there to destroy your opponent. You're there to be utterly victorious over your opponent. But agonism is when you know that your opponent deserves respect because in your disputes between right and left or green and capitalist or whatever it is, the quality of that exchange is preeminent. So that's a question of how do you construct the spaces within which agonism can happen between political opponents rather than antagonism. And I think one of the terrible conceits of being Western is that we sorted it all out in Greece. All we need to do is go back to Plato and Aristotle and Heraclitus. I mean, the presumption of that society based on the oppression of women and the utilization of slave labor being the basis of anything is a joke. So there's a proper innovative moment, civilizational innovative moment, exactly as Jeremy says. So we have to create spaces for agonism, for beautiful, what the website calls, the activist website calls beautiful trouble rather than ugly trouble. But we need to construct these spaces with our organizational ambition and vision, not yet applied. And who knows whether technology will be able to help us do that? Who knows whether the actual technology is Ubuntu as a philosophy rather than an open source as a software, or maybe there's some conjunction of them both. But certainly what Indra and I are trying to do with Spring and with the alternative is to kind of, and I think obviously Chaos Pilots and UFA as well, is to think about the beauty of the prototype. What Beckett used to call fail better. Try again, fail, fail again, fail better. And
Agreed.
that if you can create those prototypical spaces, I'm a great advocate of the study of play in mammals and humans. And play is an interesting bit of organism's condition to look at. It encourages risks, but they're not fatal. So, it happens whenever kids start to play in refugee camps, you know that optimism and spirits are lifted. So you can even just talk about play as an example of nature giving itself options at the very core of its operations. So creating spaces that allow human beings to be as creative as David Graeber and Mr. Vengro in their book, The Dawn of Everything, amazing book of anthropology, just saying, go back to the past. Don't regard yourself as some kind of superior hierarchical agrarian creature.
Oh, yeah.
There was as much experimentation going on 15, 20,000 years ago as there is now. So I think there's a lot of resources for hope. But that was my immediate response to what you're saying. There are other structures to be invented than mafia or
Absolutely.
patriarchy.
Yes. Dangerous spaces. Normally people tell me not to bring it up, but I'm really struggling with a probable direction on this, because now that it's been mentioned, it's been agreed upon that we need to build direction in there. So I just wanted to understand what everyone else feels here.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Lovely. Jeremy and Indra would you like to respond?
Well, sure. Well, I would just quickly say, when you were first asking that question, I was going to say, essentially, over history, the most proven form of organization that has been stable in the way that you said is one of cooperativeness, is basically the commons. And that's where the work of Eleanor Ostrom is so incredibly powerful, because what we see is that these hierarchical, patriarchal structures of domination, they arose, with the rise of agrarian civilizations for the most part, even though Wengro and Graeben, notwithstanding, that became the predominant way in which history did unfold. And I don't know if you know the work of Riane Eisler, that she makes a very helpful distinction between what she calls like partnership society systems and dominator systems. Mafia, iconic example of a dominator system. But there are partnership systems that exist all around the world. And that doesn't mean it does not leave like a right wing versus left wing, or
Yeah,
aggressive
certainly.
versus reactionary, but it's two different ways of relating. And what we learn from the commons, and what we learn from this work of David Sloan Wilson, like principles of pro-social behavior, when you set the conditions for cooperative behavior, when those things get reinforced and incentivized and rewarded. That's what people want to do. We've had these horrible situations for so many millennia where the conditions have rewarded the worst kind of patriarchal, militaristic kind of behavior. And because they get rewarded, that culture reiterates again and again. We have to break that cycle. But it's actually one, what we have on our side is this is what human beings actually want, is to live more in that peaceable kind of place.
Thank you.
Lovely. Indra, would you like to come in?
Yeah, it's such a huge subject, and I do think it's the one of the most important, actually, and something to be watching, in the news now. Where are we going with war? And although we're dominated with headlines from the wars that have recently erupted, a trend that is not being reported in the mainstream news at all is the difficulty that countries have now in recruiting armies. And it's become particularly very visible in Europe, the growing reluctance of young men to go to war or to join the army, and the growing reluctance of mothers to send their boys to war. So this is something that you won't read about in the papers. In the UK in particular, you'll be hearing that there's no budget, the scandal and the shame that this government is not paying enough money to raise the army. But the truth is they can't recruit the people. That's the thing they're not telling you. And it's part of the public space becoming so much more intelligent around the difference between conflict and violence. We know that conflict is inevitable and enjoyable. Energy lies in conflict, as Pat was describing.
Yeah.
But violence does not have to come after conflict. It doesn't have to be the result of conflict. In fact, somebody mentioned before, and Ufa, I think you mentioned Johan Galtung, who was a great pioneer of this understanding that conflict should lead to transformation, not to violence. And that is the way contained groups of people, and when I say contained, I'm talking about families and communities, where there is a boundary around the people who are in the conflict, that they can really relate to each other, then conflict leads to transformation because the community doesn't want to use violence upon itself. So this is just our growing intelligence in the public space that I think will have very clear outcomes for the future. There are people who don't believe that war will ever be obsolete. I'm one who believes it absolutely can be.
Thank you very much for this very strong affirmative comment, and that brought us to the end of two hours conversation. It went like this, and thank you to everyone to stick around, and I do want to especially thank Wendy as well for her latest comments, which are so powerful and valuable. I wish you came in live, but now I do need to seize the session. Thank everyone. And I hope that this is just the beginning of a long journey. And the research that was presented today by Ecocivilisation, by Ufe, by Indra and Pat, and by Jeremy, we will continue to interweave, and we will continue to learn from each other, and we will continue to demonstrate that helping each other, supporting each other, can actually lead to a stronger thoughts and actions of all of us. And if nothing else, I leave today's discussion with a very optimistic view that we are not in a vicious circle, but in a spiral one, where we are engaging in the co-creation of the future. And let's continue. It's a long journey. Let's continue to get closer to nature. For some reason, nature knows how to balance things all the time. We just gotta find our way back to relearn how to do it and how to be part of it. So thank you very much to all of you. and have a lovely evening, and see you at the next discussion.
Thank you, Violetta.
Thank you. I'm coming for you.